like thunder and lightning. You heard me without trying. A tempestuous rising. No, I don't like to be this way. And you're Jekyll and hiding. Are you real, are you lying? So stop with your crying. I can't handle it now. You tell everyone our love went cold. Going around spreading the word it's over. If that's how you feel, then you should go. Don't come around saying I still want you. One minute you say you're a team, then you're telling me you can't breathe. Well, you should set me free. Baby, if you're over me. Yesterday you said I'm the one, but now you say you're done. Stop telling me what I need. Baby, if you're over me. There you go, there I said it. Don't look at me all offended. You played games till it ended. I've got to look out for me. I won't say that it's easy. Oh, I know I hate leaving. But you can't keep deceiving. Does it make you feel good? You tell everyone our love went cold. Going around spreading the word it's over. If that's how you feel, then you should go. Don't come around saying I still want you. One minute you say you're a team, then you're telling me you can't breathe. Well, you should set me free. Baby, if you're over me. Yesterday you said I'm the one, but now you say you're done. Stop telling me what.
Right, so I hope you all have a great Labor Day. Is my voice still sounds okay? Yeah, I don't want to tell you too much about my long weekend, but you know, I had a, yeah, we actually like spent, you know, this is the longest ever karaoke that I ever had in the past, because we had a group of people, we sing together. And, you know, sometimes you feel like you are getting older because it used to be like, okay, when I was at your age, right, it's okay that I sleep late and the next day I'm still energetic. But the aftershock is actually taking me like 2 days to get recovered. And I'm not sure if I'm still doing good today. But, you know, I will try my best to give you a good lecture today. But the topic we are going to talk about today, okay, I still get it right. Programming on multi-threaded architectures. Because you must remember, if you don't remember, I hope you remember. In the last week, we talked about parallel architectures. And in fact, there are three different parallelism that you can now find in your modern systems. So the first type of parallelism, we actually spend a lot of time in talking about this. It's actually instruction level parallelism. So the most famous technique of exploiting instruction level parallelism is actually superscalar. So why superscalar is a method of exploiting instruction level parallelism? Because instruction level parallelism is actually the fact that in our modern hardware, we are allowed to execute multiple instructions from the same running program instance, which is referring to either process of thread in operating systems. So if it's from the same process or the same thread, and you run it on the same hardware, at the same time, that's called instruction level parallelism. And superscalar is obvious a technique for that. And we have been talking about how can we max out the performance of superscalar, and that's actually out-of-order execution plus register renaming. And then we start to talk about the second type of parallelism, because remember, when we talk about superscalar, no matter, and in your homework, you already did that, right? There are programs that no matter how many functional units we give you, how wide the fetch or renaming issue logics are, you still can have only very limited amount of parallelism, right? You must experience that in your assignment 4. If you didn't, I'm sure that you didn't turn in the assignment. But there are always the case like that. So, but you know, the good thing is that nowadays we are in a world of multitasking, multi-threading. So it turns out that, okay, if we cannot find instructions from a single program to fully utilize the hardware resource we have, why don't we try to execute more programs at the same time, so that the overall throughput of running this set of programs or this set of threads will be better. However, as you are aware, because in this way, you are also sharing your resource, no matter it's caching or the underlying interconnect. So the performance of each thread or running process might not be as good as the case where you dedicate the whole processor to a single program. However, the overall throughput of running this set of programs will be better. And this is called thread level parallelism. And we have been talking about two methods of exploiting thread level parallelism. The first one is simultaneous multi-threading, which your processor fake two front ends to the operating system. So the operating system would have the illusion that, okay, you have two processors, but physically they are a physical processor. So it turns out that a physical processor can run multiple programs at the same time. Another one is that we just duplicate the processor cores. However, instead, if we can have the same area having a very advanced wide issue processor core with a duplicated processor, we might be able to use the same resource to provide more processor cores for you. So that's chip multiprocessor. And that's another way of exploiting thread-level parallelism. And the next one is called data-level parallelism, which we are going to talk about today, if we have time. So that's another type of parallelism that we haven't talked about. So here's a concept of simultaneous multi-threading. So remember, right, even though we have pretty wide issue processor, however, the parallelism that we have is pretty limited. So one thing that we could do with simultaneous multi-threading is that instead of trying to seek for more parallelism from the same program, let's try to grab instructions from another program, and turns out that you can completely fill the pipeline. So that's simultaneous multi-threading. And as I mentioned, the concept of simultaneous multi-threading is that we present two front ends. Pretty much you give the operating system a separate core ID, and each core ID would be mapped to an individual program counter, so you can track the progress of each running thread on different on the same processor without getting confused. So that's simultaneous multi-threading. And another trend that we just talked about is called chip multi-threading, a chip multi-processor. And the reason of chip multiprocessor is that nowadays, if you want to implement a very advanced core, it takes a lot of transistors. But if you don't want to have that many that advanced cores, which most of the time you don't need that many issue in your to run your process process or threads mostly, then you can put more processor in there, right? So that's another way that you can improve the parallelism of your running your program. So that's chip multiprocessor, and chip multiprocessor or simultaneous multi-threading, they all have their pros and cons. And as we discussed intensively in the last week, there is no clear win of each side. So it turns out that nowadays, every processor, every high-end processors that we are having is pretty much a combination of simultaneous multi-threading and chip multi-threading. However, the most important thing is that without programmers' effort of making your progress, making your program multi-process, multi-program, multi-threaded, there's no way for this hardware to accelerate a single program. So that's why we need a lot of programming support for the parallel programming, and that's our topic for today. So in the last week, we also talked about nowadays, if you want to make a accelerate a single program with this multi-threaded hardware, you have to make your program multi-threaded. And there are several different ways of doing it. And one way is through process abstraction. And in modern Unix system, with process abstraction, each process is considered as a separate program. They have their own individual virtual address space. So it turns out that the only way you can communicate, exchange data in this multi-program environment is through file systems. And another one is called thread. And with thread, the most common type of thread is called POSIX thread, pthread. So with pthread, you are able to create several instances sharing the same virtual address space. The only difference is that each thread can be at a different progress of the program. However, they are able to see each other's data. So that's the parallel parallel programming abstractions. However, these abstractions, they are created by the software. On the hardware side, we only have the concept of program counter, memory addresses. So no matter which one you're talking about, we all refer them to threads. So as I just mentioned, right, there is always a beautiful misunderstanding between software people and hardware guys, because we seldom talk to each other. And one of the biggest mistake or biggest misunderstanding between this thread programming model and modern hardware is that the thread programming model assumes the processor looks like this. You have cores, you have shared memory. So it's very natural that we map the shared virtual address space to the shared memory and map each thread to a processor core. And turns out that it ignores the fact that we have cache. So if I have a data, if I have a thread that modifies a variable that is supposed to be shared among the thread, then other ones won't be able to see the change. So that caused the problem, right? So today we are going to talk about how architecture support is going to fix this problem. And it turns out that one example that I try to give you such very live experience example is the coherence and consistency, right? So when we say about coherence, it's more about at the same time when somebody is querying the status of the data, the value of the data, they should see exactly the same data. So that's called coherence. And another one is called consistency. It's about all threads should see the change of data in the same order. So the ordering, who goes first, who goes later, that's consistency. And coherence is not about the update order, is more about at least as long as everyone sees the same, it's good, right? So one example that I gave you is about the Asian parents example, right? Like people would like to call, parents would like to call your friends, like, okay, where is Brandon, right? For example, right? And then you definitely want to make sure that it's coherent among your friends. Okay, Brandon is currently studying really hard in the library. By no means he will be in a bar. Right, so that's coherence, right? Everyone agree that Brandon at this time, no matter who asks where Brandon is, he must be in the library. That's coherent, right? But if someone says Brandon is in the library, someone say he's in a PR center, right? Then that's not coherent. Okay, so you know sometimes parents are very intelligent. They are aware of the coherence issue. the coherence protocol among you guys, right? So one thing I would like to ask is that, okay, do you know if Brandon ate already, right? Then it becomes an issue, a consistency issue, right? Then your friend must also agree that, okay, Brandon ate first and then go to the library, or go to the library first, ate later, right? So this is pretty much the difference between consistency and coherence. So coherence is about the same time, everybody sees the same. However, consistency has more of the ordering, has the time series information in there. So that's the biggest difference. So let's talk about coherency first, because it sounds easier for us to maintain coherency, right? So the most basic, the basic protocol is called snooping protocol. By snooping, it means that we are trying to overhearing the information of the connected, of the interconnect that all the cores are connecting to. So, and again, it still leverage the same cache architecture that we have on each core, but we just simply extend the states that we have. And if you remember previously, for each cache block, we have a state code, we have a state that is calling valid, invalid, right? And now we just extend that state to have two more things there. One is called shared, the other is called exclusive, right? Exclusive means that only one core has the exclusive rights of altering the data. And the other is called shared, means that everyone can read the data. Everyone can read the data, right? So I don't want to have a lot of, you know, inappropriate analogy on that, but you can imagine that applies to a lot of things in our life, right? Especially personal relationships. But how we maintain that in the cache architecture, right? So remember, we have the valid bit, and originally we only have valid invalid, but right now we have two different states, two more states, shared and exclusive, in addition to invalid. So now, it's a two state, two bit states, right? And how are we going to maintain that state? So it turns out that the protocol start every block with an invalid state, right? That's reasonable, because in the very beginning, there's nothing there. And when I had a cache miss, which triggered my cache to fetch the data from the lower level memory hierarchy, is basically triggering a read miss event. And if you are the one who triggered the read miss event, meaning that you are the one who require the reading status of the block. So it turns out that the block could be set to a status that is shared, right? So it's pretty like personal relationship, right? If I just try to dating someone, right? Doesn't mean that we are in a relationship, right? So the other party is by default can date with anyone that is not in a relationship with that person, right? Although that's not always true, but by default, that's the case, right? So in that case, it means it's a shared state, right? Everyone can take the cache block, right? So that's a shared state. And if we just keep asking to read the data, right? Then we can keep looping at the shared state. On the other hand, if someone is trying to grab the right of modifying, alter the data, right? It means that, okay, after doing this, the processor would be the only one has the up-to-date information of the cache block. So it turns out, even though the block already exists in the cache, we still want to broadcast a write-miss information to the rest of the cores, right? Pretty much declare the exclusive states of the cache block on this particular processor, right? So for other processor heard that the cache block has been written by another core that is not me, right? You know, okay, it has been declared as exclusive, right? So then on my end, right? It's going to be invalid, right? So that's the transition, right? So a cache block can be shared on multiple processor cores. However, if one of the processor cores declare a block as exclusive, then others must have the same block invalidated, right? So you might have the question, what if other block wants to read the modified data again, right? Then again, you have to request a readme broadcast on a bus, right? And with this information, right, what happened is that the core that owns that block has to write back the data to a lower level memory hierarchy and change the state of the block to share state that everyone can read it. So that's the transition of this protocol, right? So that's the basic concept. And there are lots of different deviation of this protocol. But the basic idea is that, remember, we have these three different states. And if it's shared, it means that the data is pretty much read-only. A lot of people may have it. If it's exclusive, then I have the right to write it. However, if it's invalid, if I want to read it, or if I want to write it, I have to broadcast the message, and it will result in invalidation. It will result in the cache block being written back first and make it shared again, right? So that's a transition. So what happened, we can run the coherent protocol again, right? So remember previously, everyone start with the sum value equal to zero. And now if someone wants to modify it as dead thief, right? Then before we can start doing that, we have to broadcast a message on the bus saying that, okay, I'm going to do something with the cache block. So everyone else stop sharing this cache block, pretty much like, okay, I'm going into a relationship with this cache block, don't date the cache block, right? Pretty much like that. And then everyone's copy got invalidated, and the cache block on the core becomes exclusive, right? So if somebody wants to modify the data again, right? Well, this is definitely not a case for a personal relationship, but for the coherent protocol, it's pretty much like, okay, if somebody wants to modify that cache block again, all you need to do is that, okay, I broadcast a read miss message on the bus, right? And then the block, the exclusive, the core with the exclusive access to that block has to write back the data to a lower level memory hierarchy and change its status to shared. And because you write back the data, so everyone can pretty much fetch the up-to-date data from the lower level memory hierarchy. And now you see both these two cores, they all have the up-to-date data at this time. If this block wants to modify the data, it has to go through the same process to make it exclusive and invalidated on this one. Okay, so it sounds like this process would work, right? So now I'm going to show you a demo regarding how it works, right? So now here I have a very simple code, and I have a variable called loop, which is a global variable. And if you understand the scoping concept in C programming language, if you declare a variable as a global variable, both these two functions, they are able to see it. And now, because I learned multi-threading, so I want to run these two functions on two different processors. So thread one is pretty much a main thread that create a thread first, which runs on the second processor core. And what I'm going to do is that I check the value of loop. And if it's not one, right here, if it's one, I will continue, right? But if it's not one, then I will terminate the thread and display the user input, right? So that's the demo that I'm going to show you guys. And let's see how this example would work out. Hello. All right. So this is. Okay, so, hello. All right, let me restart it. You know, sometimes. Okay, so the processor that we are going to use today is still this lovely Intel. Sorry, not this one, but okay. Let me do this. So I'm going to use this processor that's on my Jupyter host. It's the 13th generation Intel Core i7, pretty advanced cores. And what I'm going to do is that, okay, this is the code that you are seeing, right? So I do have a global variable. I do have the function. And right now I'm going to run this code. And the first version that I'm going to run is a version without optimization. So let's run it. And as you can see, I input a number 100, right? So you see 100 is outputted, right? So it's definitely a case where this code is functioning. So, you know, in this case, we try to emphasize that if for some minor code optimization, you can actually leverage compilers. So, as a good practice, you should always try to turn on your compiler optimization. So what I'm going to do here is that, okay, I turn on the compiler optimization. Now I start running it, right? And we'll figure out that, okay, so previously when I run this cell, the result is coming up immediately, right? But this one doesn't really work out. Doesn't really work out, right? So why? Why is that? And in fact, this code would never finish. Okay, awesome, right? So you guys already, that's a good sign because it sounds like you start doing the lab. Right, so the thing is that, okay, in a lab or in compiler class, you might already learn constant propagation, right? And in fact, in compiler, they will do a lot of optimizations. However, the biggest limitation of compiler is that they are optimizing based on the function granularity. So when they try to optimize code, they are only seeing that a function, not the whole program. So what would happen is that they would always do local optimization within the function. So they would optimize the code here and modify loops separately. So from the main function's perspective, I see a function loop being assigned to one, right? So constant propagation loop is going to be one. And do you see other places in this function modifying the value of loop? Not at all. All we do is reading, right? So compiler decided this is really a good function that we can do constant propagation. So here, right, since loop is one, one is always equal to one, right? So this is an infinite loop, right? So the code would keep getting here without a chance of getting out. Because after constant propagation, they would assume the value is always one, so the loop is always executing, right? So a lot of cases, people were asking me, okay, why don't we by default turn on compiler optimizations? That's the reason, right? So there are chances that we are going to get it wrong. So you will feel very sad. Okay, so does that mean if I want to use multi-threading, I'm losing the chance of getting my code optimized? And the answer is you have to specifically tell compilers there are things that you shouldn't optimize. So for this particular case, right, you want to tell the compiler, don't do optimization on a variable loop. So here, the biggest difference is that in front of the integer, I put a keyword called volatile. So bottle means that I would suggest the compiler. So bottle means that this value can be modified by somebody else, right? So which means that the compiler should never first put variable as a register variable. So it will allocate a memory location to store the value of the variable. And a second thing, don't do constant propagation. Always check the new value, right? So turns out with this optimization, right? Let's run it again, right? Let's do the test with volatile, right? So this, okay, let me compile it. And let's do it. Okay, so this time it finishes. And let's try the optimization one, right? It also finishes, right? So this tells you, okay, if there are risks of compiler optimizations in the multi-threading case, right? And as you can imagine, what's the consequences if I put volatile? So some of you might say that, okay, if I have a multi-threaded program, why don't I just put volatile in front of every of my variable? What's the consequence of that?
You adding a bunch of overhead.
What kind of overhead? But here I don't have locking, right?
Oh, is it not?
No, I mean, what? It's automatic, right? So, okay, how volatile avoids the problem that we mentioned previously? How do we deal with the variable? It has what? No, right here we are having a spread that keep looping, right? What's the cost of that? So previously, without this volatile, what can compiler do with the variable? And what caused the program outcome to be wrong? What? Treat it as constant, and what's the benefit of it? Why compiler wants to do that? It doesn't have to memory to perform memory access, right? And it can also, if you can shorthand it as one, you got a lot of save on the instruction count as well, right? So, okay, if I do this on every variable I have, what does that mean? You will have a lot of memory accesses, right? Potentially cache misses, and your performance is going to be worse, right? So that's why there's a fine line here, right? And that's actually the programmer's responsibility to identify what are the words, what are the variables that you need to declare as volatile, right? Instead of having everyone as volatile, right? So now you know, like being a programmer, there are more things that you have to do as in the multi-core programming era, right? So the thing is that, right, we just want to make sure that, okay, for the variables that we really care about in multi-threaded programming, we have to make sure that it's a volatile has a volatile keyword in front of it to make the compiler less aggressive on optimizing it. Okay, so now let's assume I have a key variable that I already use volatile to deal with it. What do you think about the output of this piece of the code?
All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Oops, sorry. 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, let's see what you guys think. Okay, what a lovely graph. So why don't we discuss with your friends for another 90 seconds and let me see what you guys think afterwards. Go. All right, it looks like you guys start to have a consensus, huh? So why don't we have 15 seconds? Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay. Okay. Change a little bit. So what do you guys think? All possible, one is not possible. What do you guys think?
I know that 1, 3, 4 is possible.
1, 3, and 4 is possible. That's a good observation, right? How about then, why don't you think this one is possible? Yeah, so here's the thing, right? If you look at these two threads, right? Even though I have compiler optimization, even though I have out-of-order scheduling, right? So remember out-of-order scheduling. We have a reorder buffer. So is the processor going to present the result in different orders? Different orders of your program? Probably not. All right. And if you look at this code, right, this is keep increasing. And the other side, it doesn't modify the variable at all, right? So there's only one possibility is that the value occurs when the time evolves, right? We are going to see the value increasing. So this is for sure. So this one is not possible. And the first one is actually what we want, right? That's the purpose of the program, right? But after learning this multi-threaded architecture, you probably know, right? It's potentially not possible, right? Like Jack said, right? It's non-deterministic regarding your operating system. When is it going to launch your process, launch your thread, right? Maybe it starts in the middle, maybe it starts at the end. Maybe they can interleave, right? So to show you this, right, I actually had a demo, right? So hopefully that will convince you. And in fact, what happened, right? And it also tells you how non-deterministic in the execution of your program. So now I have this particular code, right? So even though my cache is coherent, right? Coherent doesn't solve the problem, right? So let me see. Okay, so that's okay. So that's pretty much another version of the code that I just showed you, right? So I just replaced the. I have another thread, and whenever the loop reaches 100, it will terminate, right? So that's pretty much a pretty similar one to the program we have. And it's already declared volatile, so both of them are supposed to see it, right? So now let's try to make it make the program. And this time I turn on the optimization flag, so it's dash 03. So the first run of it, right, what did you see? I see a one, I see a lot of ones, and then I see an eight, then I see 100, right? So where is my 2 to 7 and 9 to 99, right? The answer is that the other thread won't see it, all right? So a lot of cases that you see, you would imagine in a multi-threaded programming era, the other thread is going to see everything happening on the other core. The answer is no, right? Only when the time that I request the access, I will go to see, right? And that requires the coherent protocol to work out, right? And some of you might think, okay, is it always like 1, 8, 8, and 100, right? So to show you how wrong is this, I try to run it for several other instances, actually, I think 5 times here, and I try to catch the last, right? So here you see 1, 12, and 100, and here you see, oh, 1 and then 100, right? And here you see 1, 8, 100 again, and 1, 37, 100, and 1, 100, right? It's not deterministic, right? And the thing is that the one that we imagine, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, 8, 9, is never going to show up, right? It's never going to show up because it's rare that our system has a chance of getting your code running deterministically, right? Isn't that hard? Isn't it really hard to do multi-threaded programming now? What do you guys think? Is it hard? Very difficult, right? So for this particular question, the only thing that would not show up is actually the second one, right? Others are all possible. And in fact, in most cases, you won't see number one, right? So if you pick two, I would actually, if you can have only two, if the question is like, which one is more likely to show up, you should get four. And in fact, one is never showing up in, I mean, I have been running it thousands of times in every class, every lecture, it never shows up as one, right? Of course, for two, it's impossible, right? So that's it. Okay, so maintain cache coherence. There are also a potential problem that we are going to see. So remember, right, when we maintain a coherence protocol, it's block by block, cache block by block, right? And how many, so you must remember, right, how big is a block typically nowadays? 64 byte block, right? How many double variables can you put into a 64 byte block? 8, right? So what will happen is pretty much like this. So saying that right now I have this 4 threads and they all have a block containing data from 80 to 83, right? And now thread 0 is trying to modify A0. And then turns out that it's going to invalidate everyone's copy of A0 to A3 just because I want to modify A0, right? Now, if another thread saying that thread 2 wants to modify the value of A2, so it turns out what will happen is it will broadcast a read miss message on the bus and then force the A2, the whole block containing A0 to A2 to write back, right? However, if you compare the new version and the current version, which is invalidated here, are we changing A2 at all? No, right? But it's still going to be a miss here, right? So this is another type of miss in our code in multi-threaded era. So given that, can you tell me which version of this piece? Two pieces of code is better. They all generate the same result. All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, time is up. Okay, so we have a pretty close call for A and B. So why don't you guys discuss with each other to see which one is better? Go! All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, time is up. Okay, change a little bit. Now A is slightly more than B, and I don't see other answers. Okay, that's a sign of discussion. So what do you guys think? L or R, which one will have better performance? L or R? L, R, L, R, which one?
So I said R.
You said R?
R is better because we think it takes like better consideration of like the underlying memory system.
Mm-hmm.
It would kind of have things in more of a column order, like where things are more consecutive.
Okay, so you think R would give a more consecutive access to your items. How about others? What do you guys think, L or R? Why are you laughing? What do you think? You have no idea? Okay, not 100% sure, right? Okay, so, you know, sometimes you are appropriate. Okay, what do you think? Depending on number of threads? Well, okay, if it's one, that's the same. Okay, I agree. How about two? If you have more than one thread. The right one, okay. Right, so if you look at the pattern of accessing, right? So if you are thread zero, right? If I'm thread zero, who are you going to who are you going to access here? So I'm going to start with thread zero, right? And then my next one, so saying that if I have two threads, right? The next one I'm accessing is one or two or three. Two, right? So I'm going to two. And how about the next? Four, right? And if I'm thread one, what am I going to access? I'm starting with, because my thread one, right? I start with TID equal to one, right? And then what's in my next? Three, right? Because the number of thread is two. So the next one is three, right? And five, right? So it's pretty much like, okay, I have two different cores. One is A0, A2, right? A4, right? And this one is pretty much like A1, right? A3, A5, right? Okay. Do you remember what I show you? it's very similar to the concept of tiling, but it's not about the tiling that we try to do before, right? Because previously when we do tiling, we are trying to tile your data into chunks that fits into a cache. But here we are simply partitioning your data in a coarser grid, right? So, okay, so that's the left-hand side one, right? And as you can imagine, for the left-hand side one, right, these guys may all belong to the same cache block, right? So one will kick out another, right? And here, I'm trying to do, okay, if I have two threads, right? What I'm trying to do is pretty much, okay, if I have an array size this big, right? So I'm pretty much starting with zero and the second half of the array, right? So for example, if it's 1K, I will probably start with 512 here, right? And everyone goes here, this direction, right? So here I'm probably like 801 until A512, 511. And here I'm pretty much like A512 to whatever, right? And unlikely they are going to share the cache blocks, right? So as we can imagine, the left-hand side, this is your access pattern, and the right-hand side is pretty much your access pattern. So it turns out, who is going to have more cache misses? The left-hand side, right? And now you know, okay, originally we said there are three C's in cache misses, but in the era of multi-core programming, we are going to have the fourth C that's actually called coherence miss, right? And it's because a block getting invalidated by another thread. And the thing is that if the coherence misses belongs to the case where we have true sharing. So for example, like the previous loop example of the volatile variable, if everyone shares that, that's actually a type of cache misses that we want to experience, because with cache misses, that's the only way we can get the data updated. So that's called true sharing. And that's actually a type of coherence miss that we want. However, the second type of miss, that's actually what we want to avoid, that's called false sharing. So like the previous example, the vector add example, right? We are trying to update like C's 0 to 4. And the other one is updating C's 1, 3, 5, right? They are different memory locations in terms of the programmer's perspective. However, the hardware actually maps to the same cache block. So if you update any of them, it will have to invalidate the whole block. So even though I'm not sharing the same variable, I still get my block got invalidated. So that's called false sharing. And that's the type of programming behavior that you want to avoid in the multi-threaded era. So for this particular question, R is better because the cache miss rate is lower. All right, so now one more interesting question. For this pieces of a code, can you tell me and assume that the cache is still coherent, right? How many of the following outputs will you see? All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay. Woohoo, I love this graph. So why don't you guys go ahead and discuss with your friends and let's see what you guys think after discussion. All right, let's wrap up in 15 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Time is up. Okay, what do you guys think? Woohoo! So we got D as the most popular answer. So which one don't you guys agree? Which one don't you guys agree? 0-0. It shouldn't happen, right? Okay, let's run it. Okay. Okay, so let me see. Okay, so this is the actually the demo that I have for the previous question. And for the previous question, right? So I want to show you a demo for that. So the L version has a cash miss of 18 million and the R version only have 22 million, right? So that's actually the demo that I forgot that I do have the demo, okay. But for this one, so that's actually the code, right? So I have these two programs and, you know, sometimes people might say, you know, one thread start earlier than the other. So this time for this pieces of demo code, I actually add a little bit more. So here I'm having a variable called go. So once everyone sees the go being modified as zero, then everyone would jump out from the loop and execute this pieces of code, right? So you know, I'm trying to minimize the chance that one thread is always running ahead of the other. Okay, so now I'm trying to make the code. And then as you can see here, I'm trying to use -03, so it's fully optimized. And now I'm trying to run it. And I run it for 5,000 times on this lovely Core i7 13 700 processor, and let's see how many has been. Okay, did you guys see that? So here I use grep to grep how many instances is showing in the output. So what did you say is impossible? So you said 0-0 is impossible. There is actually one here, right? So there is one instance of 0-0. And the most instances are actually 0-1. So we have 9,000 also here. I think I run it for, I run this twice. So actually it's 10,000 times. So I have 9,944 instances of 0-1. I don't have any 1-1. Although you guys know 1-1 is the outcome that we are supposed to see, right? And we have 55 instances of 1-0. Are you going to give up on multi-threaded programming, right? But why, right? I mean, okay, I totally get you. And I love you again, because I love the answer you gave me, because that's actually the outcome that people would feel the most unlikely to happen, right? So most of you would think, you know, this is pretty easy to understand, right? One start with zero, right? Saying that, okay, threat one runs first, right? So I have A equal to zero, A equal to one, right? And then, well, you know, non-determinism, right? And operating system can run another thread in the meantime, right? So, and you know, maybe thread one is slower. So between A equal to one and X equal to B, the thread two may be making faster progress, right? So it actually has B equal to one, Y equal to A, right? So it turns out, this is how are we going to see 1-1? And that's what we hope the code could do, right? Either way, but it's not happening, right? So what happened the most is probably this case, right? Where one thread is always running ahead of time and the other is running later. So that's 0-1. Or this thread is running later, the other thread is running faster, 1-0. But this one, why, right? Why? How come does it happen? How come? Do you want to guess?
Isn't there a main thread? So it's the main thread,
but
sees never see those actually execute.
No, because we have T thread join after this two threads finish. Right? So that's not happening before. Why?
Don't see each other's updates, right? Is that
what... They don't see each other's updates, but when you join, because we print in a main thread, right? So it doesn't matter if they see each other. Well, yeah, we print in a main thread, right? So they don't see each other, but assume that we have coherent protocol, right? How come you're going to see 0-0? The answer is because we have out of order schedule. So you might think, wait, why, right? But remember the out of order scheduling. How are we going to schedule our statements or instructions? There's no dependency, right? So there's no dependency between them, and there's no dependency between them. So I can actually make this faster, right? And this one doesn't need to, right? There's no data dependency. So they could be out of order, right? They could be out of order, right? So turns out processor compiler, not only the processor can do it, right? The compiler can also do it again, right? Maybe it's not the processor do it, but the compiler does that, right? So the thing is that the processor see or the compiler see, oh, there's no dependency between them, right? So we can actually reorder them to make it a better performance, right? So, and again, we said coherence protocol, what we care about. If someone wants to ask for the value of A, everyone answers, right? So if you look at what happened here, right? None of these scenarios would break the rule of coherent protocol, right? Because here, oh, I is killed Y equal to A and B equal to one out of order. But I did my job in reporting the right value of A at this moment. And that's actually the reason why you see y equal to a is equal to zero, right? Because this means that the coherent particle is working. Otherwise, you won't even see zero as the value, right? So the coherent particle is actually working. And that actually turns out that y is zero, zero, right? And a lot of cases, we are assuming that processors would execute the thread interleavingly, but most of it's not possible. Some of them is going faster, some of them will be slower, right? And thread schedule is also non-deterministic, right? So, you know, in a lot of cases, it's very hard to predict the multi-threaded program outcome and performance. Because of that, right, there are too many factors inside your computer system that's affecting the execution of your program. So the answer is, okay, depending on the processors, in the past, when I use a slower processor, I can barely see one, one. But now when I migrate to the 13th generation of the Intel processor, I don't even see 1-1, which is supposed to be our answer, right? So how many of following outputs will we see? So I put the answer as 4 because that's actually what I am supposed to see, but as the demo, right, I only see 3, and that 3 is not, none of them is actually the 1-1, which we are supposed to see. Okay, so that means that simply coherent protocol is insufficient. So nowadays, we also need consistency protocol to make sure in parallel programming, we can make our outcome to be slightly more predictable. So but you know, what does that mean by consistency? Because it means that you have to, you guys learned the discrete math, right? Consistency protocol pretty much means that you need every thread to update the variables following a total ordering, right? And that's very difficult. And if you want everybody to execute your program, even though it's multi-threaded into the total ordering fashion, it's pretty much like a single-threaded programming, right? So that's never what we want, because it means that we are simply making the program serially executed. So the performance is just so bad. So what we are doing nowadays is called relaxed consistency. So what does that mean by relaxed consistency is that we can put instructions like what I show here is a memory fence instruction. So what's a memory fence instruction? It's basically put a barrier on the threads. So what does that mean is that so before this memory fence, you can reorder everything. After this memory fence, you can reorder everything. So it's kind of like breaking the program flow into two sections. So before the fence, I don't care how you order it, right? Before dating with me, I don't care about your past, something like that, right? And after that, I do care, right? So so here is the same thing, right? Before the fence, you can do whatever reordering. After fence, there is another story, right? So it's a separated segment of your program. And what does that imply is that if I put an end fence here, I cannot reorder the y equal to a before the fence. On the other hand, you can also not reorder this one here, right? So that's the end fence. And let's see if MFENs really solve our issues now. I hope it solves. And I would say, depending on the implementation of the processor, yes or no. So let me show you. I'm afraid it won't work. So this is, okay. So this is the version of code that I have MFENs. So here I declare a macro called update variable. And the update variable is actually this part, right? It's basically putting an assembly language called nFancier. So let me see. Now let's run it. Hopefully it will work. You know, the last time, I'm really afraid of this demo because I'm 100% for sure it will bomb. Okay, right? Things are, no, it's actually not. Okay, so I still don't see my 1-1. Let me try another machine and see if that makes difference. So sometimes all you need is to change the machine you are using. Oh, no. Okay. So that's actually CSE 142. Okay, and I think I should try to use another. Yeah, because every generation of the processor, they are trying to create a different meaning of nFancy instruction. That's what I would say. So by default, it should work. Okay. So this time, at least we see one of them is not showing up, but you know, the 1-1 case is still rarely seen, right? So you know, it's so difficult to have a 1-1 case in your code, right? So, I will try to fix it next time. I think I have an idea how to make it work. Right. So, so the reason, so you guys remember, right, in a previous demo, I tried to put a while goal, right? And the reason why I have to put it is because, as I said, I want to make sure that both threads will start working after they see the goal variable being modified. And I didn't put it here. So that's why it doesn't work. So after putting nFence, what you are seeing is that always one thread going ahead, the other one. Right, but at least you don't see the case of 0-0, right? But for this, for what I have right now is because of the case where one is always going before another. So that's where the problem we are seeing. Okay, so I think I know how to fix this. Next time, I will try to show you, right? But you know, even the professor's demo doesn't always work out, right? So the takeaways of parallel programming, you guys might be thinking about, What did I just listen in the past 70 minutes, right? But the thing is that, okay, processor behaviors are non-deterministic, right? You cannot predict which processor is going faster. You cannot predict when the operating system is going to schedule your thread. And cache coherency only guarantees that everyone would eventually have a coherent view of data, but not when, right? And consistency is very hard to support, right? Like I inserted the nFence instructions, but does it really work? Not really, right? So parallel programming is hard. That's actually the takeaway that I want to give you. Okay, so another type of parallelism that we don't talk a lot in our textbook, but it's actually increasingly important. That's called data level parallelism. So the idea of data level parallelism is that we are able to process multiple streams of data using the same set of instructions or program at the same time. So that's called data level parallelism. So let's go back to this Elder Lake architecture again. So most of the stuff you already understand, right? But there is a colony that I never talk in the lectures. That's actually this part. And if you check, what they have here is VC. And why it's called VC? Because it means vector. So in fact, in your processor nowadays, they have a vector engine, which supports a set of vector operations. And so the most significant one is probably this FMA, fused multiplication and accumulation. So what they will do is like pretty much calculating a dot product of two vectors, which are intensively used in multiplication, matrix multiplications nowadays, right? So that's actually, and this is a concept of how this vector hardware being implemented. So in addition to leverage the same register that we have, to support this vector execution model, modern processors, they all have vector registers, which a register itself would store multiple values that could be treated as a vector. And when you want to do computation, you load a vector of registers to a vector to an array of ALUs. And these ALUs, they share the same control logic. So turns out what will happen is that if today I want to do plus operations for this set of vectors, then turns out is that, okay, I load these vectors into these ALUs, and these ALUs, they all perform the same operations on the pair of data they received, and then output their outcome to the target vector registers again. So that, so in this way, you can see, right? At the same time, they all perform the same thing on different pairs of data and output the data to another vector register. So that's the basic idea of vector operations. And it's not only x86, ARM processor also has a Neon instruction set architecture. And for x86, they are one of the earliest to introduce the concept of vector processing back to 1999, which is about, how many of you were born at that time? Right, okay. Good to know, because you know, yesterday I just, well, you know, last weekend I was like playing badminton on campus, and I just happened to know a new friend, and he was born like in 2005. So I was so surprised, because it's way later than this one, right? So that's why I have to ask. So 1999 sounds like an old time, right? So a long time ago. So they added 8 128 bits of registers in XMN0 to XM7. So now if you code, if you see XMN0, XM1 until XM7, it means that your processor is using those vector registers. And each register can either store a single flow, like four single floating point numbers. And right now you are seeing like AVX256. That's actually meaning that each register is now 256 bit. So you can store even longer ones. And but unfortunately, our world is divided. So Intel, they have their own SSE. AMD has their own version of SSE. So they have different instructions that they want, they support nowadays. So sometimes when you program those vector instructions, it's really a painful experience. And the way how you can make sure that your code is using vector instruction is, in fact, you have to use intrinsics like this. So for example, you have to declare, okay, I want to declare this as a vector variables, and then I load vector variables with from this memory address. And this intrinsics would actually tell the compiler to generate instructions that would load 256 bits of data into this target register. And you know, sometimes, right, they would also want you to fill the vector register with zeros if or padding, right? So that's why they have also the broadcast SD. And also, if you want to perform another, if you want to perform like another operation, for example, add, right, or multiplication, you actually need to load another register, right, and then use this ugly syntax to perform multiplication and addition and store it back. Okay, pretty much assembly programming, right? So, you know, when you put this effort, you can actually see some speed up. So I also have a demo to show you how effective is that. So I guess that's actually this one. So, let me see. Okay, so this is the So this is the original block meshes multiplication that we have seen before, right? So that's also by far the best version that we have seen. So I also have another version that actually uses SSE instructions. So this is exactly the same pieces of code that you guys see. It's very ugly, I agree. However, it's ugly, but it's really, it's performing, right? So this is the performance of the original matrix multiplication. As you can see with the block matrix multiplication, the best we can do is for a 4K, I think it's 4K in the end. For a 4K by 4K matrix multiplication, we need 30 seconds. However, with vector instructions, it could be eliminated as 24 seconds, right? So not a lot, because actually I figured out that Intel processor has very good prefetcher now. And in fact, internally, your compiler can now generate this SSE instruction. So that's why the gap has been shortened. However, if you know how to use this correctly, you are actually going to get better performance for your matrix multiplications. All right, so we are going to talk more interesting stuff tomorrow. And in fact, tomorrow I'm going to give you a very up-to-date information about what modern computer architecture looks like and what are the challenges of modern architecture, and also tells you if you are acing in computer architecture, you actually have a bright future. But before we talk about your bright future, you also care about the final exam, right? Because if you don't care, if you don't pass the class, you won't have a bright future for sure. So so first of all, right, we have an assignment file due this Thursday, because according to the TA's contract, after finish the final exam on Friday, after grading the final exam on Friday, I am not supposed to ask them to do anything. Right. So if you have any regrading requests after Friday, you have to go through me. Right. And which also means that I don't want to have a deadline after final exam, because once they are done with that, it's all their, they are done with their job. And I'm not supposed to. And if there's any assignment due on after final, I have to grade it myself, which I don't want to do. I still have my life. Right. So, so assignment five has to do this Thursday. And some of you might be asking, okay, I still want to boost up my grade. So that's why I'm saying, if you submit the evaluation, and it's a little surprise to me that the teaching evaluation was not set up, but if you want to encourage your TA, because I think they invested a lot of their time in this course, submit those evaluations. And if you have approved, I would give you a full credit assignment. So if you really are short on time of finishing your assignment five, that's the shortcut. Right. Okay. Final exam will be this Friday, 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. And we also have an in-person and online session, pretty much similar to the difference that we have in the last time, similar format as the last time. However, because this is a three-hour exam, I am going to make the question about 1.5 times to 2 times more than the last time for both in-person and online. And the other thing is that I really like the discussion that we had in SMT and CMP the last time, right? So I want to hear more discussions like that in the final exam. So I will definitely put a lot of them like that, right? So for that kind of question, right, what I want to hear is that I want to hear you first talk about your opinion with a quick summarization, and then provide evidence and citation to support your opinion. So a lot of you are probably aiming at like grad school, and you know, like for grad school, a lot of you have to take GRE, and GRE analytic writing is pretty much like that format. So I am not asking you to do too much over it, but I just want to let you know that my requirement is actually pretty much fulfilling the standard of how people would argue that my opinion is right. So please respect, that's the general sense of how we tell people it makes sense, right? Okay, question?
For the final kind of content, is it going to be like half the beginning of the course?
It's cumulative, so I don't know. So sometimes it's very difficult to distinguish who is the first part or the second part, right? I can put them all together. For example, if I put a latency estimation with consideration of memory hierarchy and branch prediction, right? Are you going to categorize it at the front or the end, right? So that's different. That's like that. All right. So other than that, I will see you tomorrow, and hopefully you will learn a lot tomorrow.